Okay, very nice. So it's being recorded, Augusto. Está sendo gravado agora, né?
Sim.
Ok. Vamos esperar mais uns minutinhos. Valentin Cassano, I suppose from Argentina as well. Okay.
Here we are.
Mandando o WhatsApp, velho. WhatsApp, pode ser não. E-mail que você quer que mande? Aqui não acho mais.
Tem que tocar até todo.
Okay, Marcelo, I think the audience is now stabilized.
Yes.
Can we start now?
Yes, I suppose,
Okay.
yes.
Okay, so thank you everyone for coming, for joining us this afternoon in Brazil, afternoon well, at least. So Marcelo Coniglio will be talking about logics of formal inconsistent and a solution to the problem of replacement. It's a joint work with David Fuenmayor, Marcelo and myself, and I have to admit modestly that Marcelo did most of the work, and I thank Marcelo for that, and David has helped a lot and also helped. And this is a complicated problem, and Marcelo will show us how we managed to solve it with the little help of Isabelle. Okay, Marcelo, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Walter, for your invitation for presenting this seminar. Thank you to everybody for being here. As Walter said, this is a joint work with Walter and David Fuenmayor. David was very important for this work because he gives the ideas, the main ideas for presenting this kind of logics with replacement. Idea that at principle it seems to be very hard or even impossible, as I will comment here along the talk. And then when we obtained this paper, was during the visit of David to the Center for Logic, Epistemology and the History of Science, CLE, at Unicampi, the second semester of the last year. Okay, let us begin. Here. Here. Okay. Well, it is very important for logical system to have the property of being algebraizable, as you know, in the sense that an algebraic counterpart for the system can be given. This is important because you can deal with the inference in the logic by means of solving equations or doing calculations in a well-known class of algebras. This is very useful. We have two very important examples for classical logic that can be represented by means of Boolean algebras, and the intuitionistic logic that can be treated algebraically by means of Heitian algebra. This is the well-known examples, but there are a lot of another examples for non-standard logics. This question is very delicate in the realm of paraconsistent logics. This doesn't mean that no paraconsistent logic can be algebraizable, but several important systems cannot be algebraized. For instance, the Costa systems, CN. It is well known that their systems are not algebraizable, neither in the classical, the strong sense of Linna-Montarsky, but even in the more general sense of Bloch and Pigozzi in the context of abstract algebraic logics. These logics also are not self-extensional. This is the main subject of this talk, the self-extensionality, the property of replacement, which states that two equivalent logics in the given logic can be freely substituted into any formula preserving logical equivalence. This is a very important and useful property, self-extensionality, that is not satisfied by CN, and this negative results, let's say, does not call also in the class of paraconsistent logics, known as logics of formal inconsistency, which were introduced by Carnelli and Marcos, which are present in this talk now, in their seminal paper, A Taxonomy of C-Systems, in 2002. These logics generalize the logics of Da Costa, the approach of Da Costa, and these logics share the same negative results concerning algebraizability. Not all the LFIs, but the basic systems, let's say, which are weaker than system of Da Costa, cannot be algebraizable. That's the problem. The problem of the failure of self-extensionality is, here. Concerning self-extensionality, Carnelli and Marcos shown in that paper that replacement is unattainable without losing paraconsistency in certain axiomatic extensions of the logics BC and CI, which are two important LFIs much weaker than the Costa system C1. That is, the problem is not only with C1, but with weaker systems. In that article, an important question was posed to find extension of BC and CI which satisfies IP, the replacement property, but still being paraconsistent. This is the problem posed by Carnelli and Marcos in that paper, A Taxonomy of C-Systems. Some interesting results concerning self-extensionality and paraconsistency were analyzed by another authors. Recently, Avron and Bézieux have shown that no three-valued paraconsistent logic having a deductive implication can be self-extensional. On the other hand, after that paper, Avron shown that there is exactly one self-extensional three-value paraconsistent logic defined in a signature with conjunction, disjunction, and negation. Interesting, just one three values. Okay. Concerning the more general problem of paraconsistency and self-extensionality, Bézieux has shown in 1998, I think, that no paraconsistent negation satisfying the law of double negation and such that the schema of non-contradiction is valid, satisfying that action, that is, the non-contradiction law is a theorem, can satisfy replacement. That is, if you have a paraconsistent logic with a negation satisfying double negation and in which the negation of the contradiction is valid, can be self-extensional. The aim of this talk is presenting an extension of the usual family of LFIs, the basic ones, enjoying the replacement property. Then we will show a solution for that open problem about BC and CI, showing that it is possible to extend this logic satisfying replacement property and still being paraconsistent. And the semantics for this logic will be algebraizable because they are self-extensional, they are we can obtain an algebraization by very basic method of Lin-Montarsky, by defining the Lin-Montarsky algebra for these logics. Then will be algebraizable in the classical way, let's say, by means of a class of Boolean algebra expanded with LFI operators, as we call them, BALFIs. And we will show the relationship between this semantics and the neighborhood semantics for non-normal modal logics. Okay. Then let us begin with the definitions. The logics of home inconsistency, introduced by Carnelia and Marcos, are paraconsistent logics with connectives, primitive or not, that is, they can be defined in terms of the other or not. The interesting, the novelty here is that they introduce a primitive connective for this, expressing consistency or inconsistency, two connected, two different connectives for this. In general, it is only considered a connective for consistency. This one, I will call it a ring operator, following this, or ball, and we usually call it ball operator, but we can call it a ring operator also, expressing that alpha is consistent. What does it mean? That the logic is paraconsistent, that is, not every contradiction trivializes, okay? But if we have a contradiction plus the assumption that the logic is, the formula, the contradictory formula is consistent, then we obtain a trivial theory. That is, contradictory theories are not trivial in general, but contradictory theories, including the assumption of the consistency of the contradiction, then they are trivial. We need more information in order to trivialize the theories. That is, we are weakening the explosion law of negation. This strategy was originally adopted by Da Costa. Then we are, the Carnelia and Marcos, they generalize the approach of Da Costa, because in Da Costa logics, the connective of consistency, Da Costa used another terminology. He speaks about the well behavior of the formula, not the consistency of the formula. A formula is well behaved, instead of saying that the formula is consistent. It's a question of terminology. And for instance, in C1, the stronger of the calculi of Da Costa, the well behavior or the consistency is defined as the law of non-contradiction. Okay. Right. Formal terms, an LFI is a Tarskian, Fintarian, etc. logic defined or a signature with a negation. Okay. And where we can define all this primitive, this is a simplified version. In the original version, we have a set of formula with depends upon a single propositional variable. Just to simplify the presentation, consider a connective, okay, primitive or defined, such that the logic is paraconsistent with respect to such negation. And the other important thing is that if you have a contradiction plus the assumption of the consistency of the formula, we trivialize. These two conditions, these ones, are just in order to provide a non-trivial solution to item 3. That is, for some formulas alpha and beta, alpha together with ring alpha and not alpha together with ring alpha should not be trivial. Otherwise, if this holds for every formula alpha and beta, then item 3 is let's say superfluous, because we are putting here three formulas and two of them are enough. Okay, this is just a technical question in order to obtain a non-trivial solution to the problem. These are LFIs. Okay. The weaker system is studied in the second paper on LFIs called Logic of Home Inconsistency, in which I have participated, published in the Handbook of Philosophical Logics, is MVC. in the previous paper, the weaker logic considered was MVC, which is an extension of MVC, of course. This logic is based on positive classical logic, CPL+, in which we add two axioms, the excluded middle for the negation and the gentle explosion law. That is, the explosion law is this one, but we require an additional hypothesis, okay, the consistency of alpha. Of course, this is done, this is presented in order to exactly satisfy the two properties of the files. The logic is paraconsistent, and these three formulas trivialize. This is guaranteed by this action. Okay, this action is the key of the solution of the problem. Okay, now let's go to the replacement property. In simple terms, could be stated as follows: if alpha, if only if beta is a theorem, then if we substitute p by alpha in any formula and p by beta in any formula, then this formula is also a theorem. This is a simplified presentation. Okay, it is well known that MVC does not satisfy replacement in general. But of course, replacement holds in MVC for any formula, positive formula, that is, or classical formula, which is expressed in the signature of the classical positive logic. This is obvious because this logic is self-extensional. Well, we introduce now the logic RMVC, that is the extension of MVC by adding replacement for every formula. Okay. From the previous observation, since replacement holds for this fragment, in this part we have replacement, the problem is, of course, with the new connectives, negation and consistency operator. Then, if we add these properties or meta-properties, if alpha, if only if beta is a theorem, then not alpha, if only if beta is a theorem, and if alpha, if only if beta is a theorem, then ring alpha, if only ring beta is a theorem, these two properties guarantees that all the connectives are congruential, because the binary ones are congruential, and then if we require to have congruency for the other new connectives, then we have a self-extensional logic. Okay, then this is what we done. The logic RMVC is defined over the signature sigma of LFIs obtained from MVC by adding just these two rules, which express the congruentiality of negation and of the consistency operator. Okay, that's all. The interesting thing is that this simple solution works fine. The only delicate point here is how to define derivations. That's all. We need to, it is necessary to look at this logic as a modal logic. That is, we need to, in order to work fine, the solution, we need to consider derivations as in modal logic, as usually done in modal logic with the local derivations, or in terms of algebraic logic, it is known as degree-preserving consequence relation that will be defined now. Well, we split the notion of derivations in two parts, the derivation of theorems and derivation from premises, okay? Derivation from theorems in RMVC is as usual, it's exactly the same definition that in any Hilbert calculus, okay? It's as usual, a definition, nothing new. Then we say that the formula phi is derivable if there is, or that it is a theorem denoted in this way, if there is a derivation. Derivation defined as usual in any Hilbert calculus, okay? By using these inference rules, okay? Fine. What about derivation from premises? Then we need a local in terms of modal logics or degree preserving in terms of algebraic logics semantics. That is, we say that phi is derivable from gamma, a set of premises gamma, if either phi is a theorem, okay, or otherwise, there is a non-empty finite subset gamma 1 gamma n of gamma, such that this implication is a theorem. That is, we reduce everything to theorems, okay? Or the formula is a theorem, then of course it is derived from every set of premises, or if it is not a theorem, we need to use gamma. How we use gamma? Not as premises in a usual derivation in Hilbert calculus, but by taking some finite subset of premises and looking for this formula to be a theorem or not. If we can obtain a subset with this property, then we say that phi is a consequence of gamma. Okay? This is exactly the same definition that we adopt in modal logics. Okay? They do the same. Okay, and this kind of consequence relation is also used in algebraic logic. No, and the name adopted is degree preserving semantics. This was a study in Barcelona by Font, Esteva, Godo, Felix Bou, and other authors. Okay, from this definition, we have the guarantee to have the very important and useful deduction method theorem, because by definition it's a trivial to prove this. Okay, by the other properties of the implication and conjunction, because we have positive classical logic underlined here, then we can prove the deduction method theorem in a very, very easy and trivial way. Okay, this is the trick. Besides adding these inference rules, we need to change the notion of derivation. Oh, sorry. This is the trick. Okay. What about the semantics? We will give an algebraic semantics for NBC by using Boolean algebra with more LFI operators. Please, it's not the same that Boolean algebra with modal operators, okay? With the Boolean algebra with modal operators, the operators interpreting in general the basic operator is for the diamond operator. Then it's required to commute with joints, but it's not the case here. They are operators. Right? Operators satisfies the actions of LFIs, of course. Then what is a BALFI, Boolean algebra with LFI operator? It is a Boolean algebra expanded with two operators, unary operators, satisfying the by means of equations the actions of LFIs. That is, the excluded middle, that is represented as the equation A or not A equal to 1, and the fact that a contradiction of a formula assumed to be consistent is trivial. This is represented by this equation. A and not A and ring A is zero. Just this. Okay? The virality, this is virality, of course, because virality means that it can is a class of algebra which can be axiomatized by means of equations exclusively. Since Boolean algebra can be axiomatized by means of equations, it's a variety, and we are expanding with two operators which can be axiomatized by the equation, we obtain a variety also. This is very useful. Okay. We consider valuation as homomorphisms, as expected, and a formula, the notion of the semantic notion, we must be coherent with the notion of derivations in the Hilbert calculus. Then we need to adopt a degree preserving consequence relation. That is, or local relation. Then we again split the notion of validity from premises in two parts, the theorems or the formulas which are valid and the formulas which are a semantical consequence, for example, of premises. Then the formula which are valid is very easy. A formula is valid when it takes the value 1 for every homomorphism in every BALFI. And a formula phi is a semantical consequence of a set of formula if either it is valid or otherwise there exists a finite non-empty subset of gamma such that this inequality holds. Okay? This is exactly the degree-preserving consequence relation. And of course, it is equivalent to say that either phi is valid or there exists a non-empty subset such that this formula is valid. And once again, validity solves everything. Okay. This is then this consequence, semantical consequence relation is defined accordingly to the syntactical consequence relation. Okay, we are coherent. Need to be coherent with the definitions of the consequent relations. Okay. Then the soundness is immediate. Okay. In order to define the proof of completeness is also easy because we prove by using the standard Lin-Montarsky method. That is very, very, very quickly we define this consequence, this equivalent relation alpha equivalent to beta if only if alpha if only if beta is derivable, is a theorem of RMBC, then since we have the actions of CPL plus, then this is a congruence with respect to the binary connectives, and we also have a bottom, then we have a Boolean algebra. Okay, and since because of the inference rules, the other connectives, negation and ring operator, are also congruential. Then this is well defined. Then we have a Boolean algebra expanded. The Lin-Montarsky algebra is a Boolean algebra with two additional operators, unary operators, which, because of this the very definition, they satisfy the excluded middle, and this is zero. Then we have Balfi, exactly. Then the Lin-Montarsky algebra of RMBC is a Balfi. Then we define the canonical valuation, sending every formula to its equivalent class, and this evaluation by the very definition of the operator, such that it gives the value 1 exactly to the formulas which are derivable in RMBC. From this, if we assuming that phi is derivable, is a semantical consequence from gamma with respect to Balfis, by using this particular Balfi and this particular evaluation, and by being approved by cases, because here we have two cases, either phi is valid or phi is derivable from a subset of formulas, then depending upon the case, we prove in the proof of cases that phi is derivable from gamma. It's very trivial. The details are trivial. Very easy to prove soundness and completeness. And we have a class of models. Well, we can find some very interesting four-valued Balfis by taking the power set of two-element set, W1, W2. Then this power set can be expressed as 0AB1, where 0 is the empty set, A is the singleton W1, B is the singleton W2, and 1 is the universe W1, W2. The Balfis defined over this domain are expansion of the power set W1, W2, and we have several possibilities for defining the negation and the consistency operator. Then we put all the possibilities in this schema here, this table. These bars here means disjunctions in the meta language, let's say. Then if Z is 1, we have four possibilities for defining the negation. Observe that in order to understand this table, we need to the requirement in each row is the following. The supremum of the first and the second column must be 1, and the infimum of the three columns must be 0. Just this, okay? This is the definition of alpha. Then observe that in each case, if Z is 1, then the negation can take any value, because 1 or supremum with any value is 1, okay? Then the negation of 1 can be any value. The negation of A is more restricted. Must be B, for instance, because A or B is 1, or 1. 0 or A cannot be imputed here, okay? With respect to B, the same thing. symmetric reasoning, and zero, just one, there is just one possibility for satisfying the excluded middle. The negation of zero must be one, okay? And observe that with respect to the consistency operator, if the negation of one is zero, then the consistency operator can be any value, because the infimum is zero because of this zero here, okay? But if the negation of one is then defined to be A, Z and not Z in this case is A, one and A is A, then we need to put here some guy which guarantees that A and this guy must be zero. Then we have just two possibilities, zero or B. This is the form in which we define the consistency operator. Okay? The consistency operator requires previously to have defined the value of the negation. Afterwards, we can define the consistency operator. Okay? And then in every row, we take the same care. And then we this is the set of all the possibilities for four-valued BALFIs. Okay? This is very useful. Several counterexamples or examples will be obtained by means of this table. For instance, in order, this is important to observe. The inference rules do not ensure that these formulas are valid. This is important to say. Okay, these formulas are not valid in general. Okay. For instance, we can by the previous example we can define this BALFI in particular. Okay, this is a BALFI because if you take here, take a look here, the supremum of the first two columns is always one, and the infimum of the three columns is always zero. Okay, then this is the BALFI. Okay. If we take evaluation such that take an instance of these formulas in which alpha is p and beta is q, where p and q are two different propositional variables, okay, and take evaluation in this algebra such that p take the value 1 and q takes the value the value a and q takes the value 1, then by using these three tables you obtain that this formula, both formulas take the value b, okay, which is not designated, is not valid. The formula is not valid because there is one valuation in which this formula takes the value b, which is not one. Okay, then these formulas are not valid. Then be careful with that. Of course, if you take an alpha if only beta, which is a theorem, then of course the formula will be both valid because the inference rules. Okay. But just in this case, just in the case that alpha and beta are theorems. Okay, how to prove that RMBC is an LFI? It is an LFI. Well, we can prove firstly that it is paraconsistent by using the previous BALFI, then with the same valuation considered above. It is, we can prove that from Q and not Q we can infer P. Okay? Then the logic is paraconsistent. Now we can consider another four valued BALFI by using that general schema, this one for instance. Okay? Observe once again the supremum of the first two columns is always one and the infimum of the three columns is always zero on each row. Then this is a BALFI, four valued BALFI. And taking evaluation in which P is 1 and Q is A, then we prove that the two technical conditions required for LFIs, P and not P, is not trivial for this pair of formulas, and also this one with another evaluation, P0 and Q B. Okay? Then we prove that this is not the case in both cases. Then, and of course, because of the inference rules, by the very definition of RMBC, this holds. Then, summing up, because of this one, and this one, we have that RMBC is an LFI, satisfies the definition of LFI. Okay, Let's turn again to the problem of replacement. Well, as observed by Canel and Marcos in that paper, replacement is equivalent to the following IP property. If you take n formulas, n pairs of formulas, which are pairwise equivalent, okay, then in any formula phi, phi replacing the variables by alpha 1, alpha n is equivalent to phi replacing the variables by beta 1, beta n. Then that is the equivalence, the interdivisibility is preserved through any formula. That's the point of replacement. Okay. Then, as I said, they put a very important question to find extension of this C and CI which satisfies IP. Okay. I don't know why this happens. I don't know why sometimes. Well, this is the slide. Okay. I don't know why this happens. It's very sensible, this button. Okay. There is a problem with the previous slide. Yeah. Well, consider some axiomatic extension of MVC. We will consider some extensions of MVC. Consider in by Canelli Marcos and in a recent book by Walter and myself. The action CIWU, which was introduced indeed by Abram. That is alpha consistent, either alpha consistent or contradictory. Contradictory. This is a very interesting action. This action allows to have the equivalence between consistency operator and the Boolean negation of the contradiction of the contradiction. That is, if you add this action to MVC, it can be proved that this ball operator, the consistency operator, is equivalent to the Boolean negation of alpha and not alpha. Then it's very useful action. These other actions are very useful also because by adding the first action, CI, you get the equivalence between no consistency or inconsistency on this side and the contradiction. The other way around holds in MVC, but if you put this action, then you obtain the logical equivalence. The inconsistency is equivalent to the contradiction. And on the other way, the consistency implies the non-contradiction. But if you add this action, CL, then you obtain the equivalence between consistency and non-contradiction. And then you can define the consistency operator as in the Acosta system, C1. Okay? These actions lead with double negations. And these three actions were considered by Acosta in his systems, concern the propagation of consistency. If you have two formulas which are consistent, both of them are consistent, then the consistency propagates through the binary connectors. Okay? This is the very useful and interesting action for LFIs. Well, a BALFI is a model of a formula where for every substitution or evaluation, the instance of the formula is holds. It's the expected, let's say. A formula is valid when it can be considered as an action schema. Then we can prove very easily that a BALFI is a model of CIW if only if the corresponding equation holds. As I say, the consistency is equal at the semantical level to the Boolean negation or the Boolean complement of the contradiction. B is a model of CI when you obtain that the inconsistency of alpha of A is equal to the contradiction, and so on. Okay, the corresponding equation holds. Then we have a correspondency between axioms and equations, once again, in the algebra. Then the axiomatic extension of RMBC are, once again, defined by means of a variety. Very useful, very important. Well, then we can extend accordingly the soundness and completeness, okay, for these axiomatic extensions. Then we take a set, a subset of this set of actions presented in the previous slide. Then RMBC expanded with these actions holds if only if the same inference holds axiomatically in the class, corresponding class of valves. Okay, then we extend the soundness and completeness of RMBC with respect to valves to axiomatic extensions. Okay. Nice. Then we can prove some properties of the calculi by means of algebraic methods. For instance, we can prove that the extension of valves by satisfying CI and CF is the same that the valves satisfying CL and CF. Of course, then they correspond to this one. Then, by using the soundness and completeness theorem stated above, then if we extend RMBC with axioms CI and CF, is the same logic as extend RMBC with CL and CF. Okay? Then if you extend RMBC with CF, then you cannot distinguish between CI and CL. If you have one, then you have the other. With respect to MBC CIW, then it is telling, observe that this equation holds in the models. Okay, then this means that this formula is equivalent to this one. Then we can, where the negation is defined in this way, alpha implies bottom, where bottom is defined in this way. Then we can change the signature of RMBC CIW, W, which will correspond to RMBC expanded by action CIW, by a formulation in this new signature. We need a bottom. Recall that the bottom used the consistency operator. Then, well, we change the consistency operator by the bottom constant, just this. And then we have the resources in order to define consistency in this way. Then the presentation is very simple. RMBC with replacement, we just need to add to C++ the excluded middle, the replacement just for negation because we don't have the consistency operator as a primitive operator, and an action saying that this constant is a bottom, just this. And the valves are also simpler. They are expansion of Boolean algebra with just one connective, the negation, satisfying the excluded middle. And if we want to talk about the consistency operator, then we use this abbreviation, just this. Okay, then the presentation is simple. And of course, this holds for any axiomatic extension of this logic. For instance, CI. Once again, I need to press in the yes. Well, next we'll give solutions to the two open problems posed by Canella and Marcos in 2002. Firstly, a paraconsistent expansion of VC with replacement. The logic RBC, that is the extension of RMBC by CF. CF, recall that say that not alpha implies alpha. And this is indeed the logic BC. BC is MBC plus not dot alpha implies alpha. Then take add replacement to this logic. Then you obtain a paraconsistent negation with replacement, of course, self-extensional, which is still paraconsistent. How we can prove that it's paraconsistent? Just by getting just one model is enough. This Balfi B prime is enough. Observe that this Balfi is paraconsistent. because in order to see that this life is paraconsistent, you don't need to prove that the negation, it is possible to have a true value such that the true value is one and the negation is also one. This is the global semantics. In this case, since our semantics is local, we need to prove that Z and not Z is not always zero. Zero is different to zero for some element. It's the only thing we need. And then we have here two elements, A and B, which are paraconsistent in this sense, because A and 1, the negation of A is 1, and the infimum is A, which is not zero. Then it is does not imply everything. The same happens with B. Then this is a paraconsistent model with local semantics of RBC. Then we get a paraconsistent extension of BC with its self-extension, okay? By the way, this is not the model of CIW, just a curiosity, okay? It's possible to prove that CIW it does not hold for A, for instance, okay? The consistency of A is zero, and the Boolean complement of A and not D, A and not A, is B, okay? Well, the other problem, which is harder, the logic CI. Logic CI was definition MBC expanded by CF, that is an expansion of BC, by adding the CI theorem, the CI action. Recall that CI states the equivalence between non-consistency and contradiction. Okay? Then, with the little help of Isabel, thanks to David, we obtain this model in a power set of four element set. Okay, in this power set, Boolean algebra, zero is the empty set, of course, one is the set of four elements, and we define the following operators. For this two element set, the negation is defined in this way. Okay, once again, Z and not Z is non-empty, is W1, then is not trivial, is not zero. The other, and the consistency is defined as the Boolean complement of the intersection, that is W1. Then it satisfies the gentle explosion law. With respect to this other guy, two elements again, the negation has one element in common to, where is, W3 is here and W3 is here, then once again Z and not Z is not trivial, is not empty, okay, then it is paraconsistent, this in the local sense, and this is the consistency operator. And for the other rows, we take a classical assumption. The complement of X, the negation, is the Boolean complement. The negation is classical. Then the consistency is, in this, every value holds, but in this case, just for simplify, the computer is smart, it puts a very economic solution, W4. Okay. Then this is a Balfi, which satisfies RCI. It's very easy to prove that the action, the non-contra, the if you take the negation of this, since these rows are different to this one, then the negation, the consistent negation of this operator is the complement. Then this the negation of this is W1, singleton W1, here is singleton W3, and here is the empty set. In three cases, the result is exactly the same that if you take the intersection of Z with not Z. And for instance, here, the intersection of this one sets W1, W2, and this one in the first row, the intersection is W3, it's in the W1, which is exactly the Boolean complement of this one. Okay, and then we satisfy the CI action. Perfect, and it is paraconsistent. Then we have a paraconsistent extension of CI, which is a self-extension, and by the way, it satisfies also CL. Okay? Nice. This system, this method, let's say, this approach to a self-extensional paraconsistent Del Fayez has limits. We cannot define any paraconsistent extension of a paraconsistent Del Fayez by simply adding replacement. This doesn't work in general. It works for this small system or weak systems. If we consider a stronger system, we have problems. Then we will show two very important examples by using a very, very important result in Carnelli-Marcos 2002, theorem 351. They found several sufficient conditions in order to guarantee that there is no paraconsistent extension of certain LFIs being paraconsistent. They show how to show that it's impossible to get paraconsistent extension of certain LFIs, extension of BC and CI, for instance, provided that the logic satisfies certain actions. For instance, recall the family of 8 kilobytes three-valued LFIs introduced by Marcos in an unpublished draft. Probably Jean Marcos never will publish this paper. I don't know. This logic was presented afterwards in several papers, for instance, in our paper, Logic of Formal Inconsistency. This very interesting family of all the three-valued LFIs satisfying certain useful properties, for instance, being conservative extensions of the two-element Boolean algebra, and so on. The implication is deductive, and so on. He puts a certain reasonable conditions and obtains all the possibilities for defining LFIs. But he also shows that in every one of these three-value logics, this schema is valid. This schema is valid. Okay? And all of them are actions of CI and CF. But in that theorem, 341, Carnelli-Marcos proved that replacement cannot hold in any paraconsistent extension of CI in which this schema is valid. And all these three value logic are a paraconsistent extension of CI in which this schema is valid. Then we cannot put additionally replacement because we will destroy paraconsistency. Okay, that's the problem. Then because of that theorem, it is impossible to use our techniques to these logics, to these matrices. It is impossible. If we add replacement because of this theorem, we will destroy paraconsistency. Okay? Of course, we can add this replacement. The logic probably will be subclassical, but they are not paraconsistent anymore. Okay, another important example, Da Costa logic C1, once again. Let us present Da Costa logic C1 in the language of LFIs. In the language of LFIs in which the ring operator is present, it can be presented as SILA, that is the expansion of MVC by this series of actions which I have shown to you in the previous slide. Okay, we put together all the actions and we obtain SILA. It is equivalent to CL1 up to language. Then add to this logic the replacement rules for consistency and for the negation. We obtain the logic R-SILA, R-MVC expanded by these actions. Okay? It can be proved that R-SILA derives this action, and bottom, on the other hand, can be defined without consistency, different to the case of MVC-CIW. Then we can take from the beginning our SILA defined over the signature of Da Costa. Then it's very easy to do this. Then by proceeding as in the case of RMVC-CIW, we can define our SILA without using the consistency operator if we want. this presentation will coincide with RC1, that is the logic of Da Costa, the original logic of Da Costa, extended with replacement. Well, the question is this logic self-extensional and spark consistent, or that is, it is possible to add self-extensionality to C1, preserving para consistency? And unfortunately, the answer is negative. Well, using once again the theorem of Carnegie and Marcus, this very important theorem, they prove between among all the sufficient conditions they found, one of the conditions was the following: IPI, the replacement, cannot hold in any paraconsistent extension of CI in which this schema is a kind of the Morgan law is valid. That is, take the logic C1. If you add this property for the negation, and you also want to add replacement, then the logic cannot be paraconsistent. That's a problem. Then, if we will return to our advice, in our book with Walter, we prove that if we take the logic MBC CIW and you extend by the propagation of consistency by means of the conjunction, just this rule, observe that this rule is one of the actions of Sila. By adding to a weaker logic, you add this propagation of consistency for the conjunction, then this is equivalent to extend by this De Morgan law. Then, by applying this to this logic, since it derives this action CIW, then it derives the schema. Then, of course, it cannot be paraconsistent because of that theorem, because it is an extension of CI which satisfies replacement and satisfies DM. Then it is not paraconsistent. And then C1 cannot be self-extensional, unfortunately. Then we show that you have limits. Well, I'm seeing that time is running very, very fastly. Then I will show the last part of the talk concerning semantics and neighborhood semantics very quickly. But I will try to explain the basic ideas. It is possible, instead of considering just Balfi, it is possible to consider neighborhood semantics, a kind of neighborhood semantics. Neighborhood frames for an MBC will be triples defined by a non-empty set W and two mappings of this type in order to interpret negation and the consistency operator. Okay, and valuations will be defined in the case of non-normal modal logics. Okay. With this, the notation of formula is defined. Well, for the classical fragment, let's say, is defined exactly as in the modal logics and in particular non-normal modal logics. Okay. With respect to the connectives, then we use the two mappings. The negation, look at this, it's very interesting. The negation is defined in a similar way and as phi implies bottom, but it is not bottom. In this case, it's an arbitrary value, and this is why this negation is weaker than the classical negation. Phi implies something, does not imply bottom. Okay, this is very interesting. And recall the property of CIW, the consistency operator is the Boolean complement of the contradiction. Well, in this case, we have almost the same. We have the Boolean complement of the contradiction, but it's not exactly the same. It's a bit stronger. Okay, we need to regulate with an arbitrary mapping here. And it works. This was the idea of David, a very nice idea of David. And it allows also to deal with this logic by using Isabella, of course, because these models are very amenable to a computational treatment of these logics. By defining validity as expected and the local consequence relation, we can obtain the completeness of RMBC with respect to this this particular class of models. It's very okay. Okay, we obtain completeness by the kind of models. Okay. But we can now relate this logic with the bimodal, minimal bimodal logic. Okay? Consider the bimodal, the minimal modal logic defined by Chelas in his book of 1980. Well, a minimal model is very similar to our neighborhood models. You take a non-empty universe and a mapping in order to interpret the necessary operator of this type, which is in fact equivalent to the type of our mappings by adjoinedness, but it is originally defined in this way. Then you, very quickly, you define the consequence relations in this way. For every, in every word, you define satisfaction. And if it denotes the set of words in which the formula is valid in such model, then you define the consequence relation, the satisfaction as expected. The classical part is in this way. And with respect to the necessitation operator, you put in this way. The denotation, the formula belongs to this set. Okay. And of the diamond is defined by duality as in classical modal logic. Okay, then this is obvious, this clause. Okay. And then it is defined the local consequence relation. This is classical minimal modal logic, which is non-normal. Okay. Why is non-normal? Because we don't require that the necessitation rule is valid. The axiomatization is given by adding to CPL plus these two actions in order to get classical logic, and then we state that the two modal connectives are interdefinable, and then you put the replacement property for just the box that is the only new connective. Then you get completeness with respect to neighborhood semantics. And this is already presented in the book by Chelas. Okay? And then the logic E is sound and complete with respect to the semantics. Okay? And as I said, the logic is not normal because you are not requiring that the universe is presented in this set. Then the necessitation rule is not derivable. It's not admissible. Okay. The last part of the talk is just finishing. I will show that the logic RMBC is definable inside the minimal bimodal logic E plus E. Well, firstly, what is the bimodal logic E plus E? Well, it's just putting together the two boxes without any interaction, just this. Okay, then you can axiomatize in this manner. Instead of taking one box and one diamond, you take two boxes and two diamonds, which are without any interaction between them. Okay, you do not allow any interaction here. Then you have the bimodal logic. It is equivalent to take the fusion of the modal logic or the fibring of the logic by sharing the classical connectives. Okay, then it's very easy to, if you expand the models by taking two mappings now, one for each box, then you obtain completeness. It's very easy to obtain this result. Okay, then this is bimodal, minimal bimodal logic. Then inside this logic, we can reproduce, we can translate the logic RMBC. Okay, how we can do this? Well, simply define as the derived connectives, let us say, the negation in this way, and the ring operator in this way. a consistency operator in this way. Then it works. We can prove that it works. That is, if you translate, this is the translation, we take any formula of the language of LFIs into the language of bimodal logics, then we obtain the following. We can prove that the logic RMBC is definable within this minimal bimodal logic in the following sense. Phi derives phi in RMBC if only if the translation of gamma proves the translation of phi in the bimodal logic. Okay? And we can do the same with axioms, with extension of RMBC. This is very interesting. Firstly, we can prove that RMBC expanded with axioms, the axioms we have considered, can be is complete with respect to the neighborhood models, the original ones, the David's models, okay, by using that power set algebra. And then, this is the first step, and then we can prove that RMBC, just by translating each action, by using that translation T, if we translate CIWU, we can obtain this axiomatic extension of E plus E. Then we can define this LFI with self-extensional with this bimodal logic. The same happens with the other axiomatic extension. If we translate this action into the modal language, we obtain this very horrible formula, and the expansion, if we add this modal action to E plus E, we obtain a logic which can encode the logic, the corresponding LFI, and the same with the other logics. Then it's interesting because we can interpret, let's say, the LFIs inside modal logics. But this connection between LFIs and paraconsistent logics, LFIs and modal logics, is well known. For instance, Desio proposed in 2002 to consider a paraconsistent negation inside S5 in this way. This, the same possibility was already hinted by Segeberg in 1982. He said that it was interesting to analyze the notion of phi is not necessarily, that is, which is equivalent to the formula considered by Bezio. And this possibility, that is, consider this paraconsistent negation, was already considered afterwards the work by Bezio by other authors, for instance, Abron for the logic B, very recently, by Prito Sanabria myself in for S4, and even for weaker modal systems by Buenzoder and Canelli. But a more general treatment of this relationship was given by Marcos in 2005, because he shows that it's possible besides this translation, that says, of a paraconsistent negation inside the modal logic, the translation of the consistency operator, a consistency operator in this way. Then he shows that any normal modal logic in which the schema, this schema is not valid, then gives origin to an LFI by means of these translations. And conversely, if you start from a modal LFI, that is an LFI which crystal semantics, then you can recover the Bose operator with this formula. It's a very interesting result by Marcos. Then he shows that any reasonable normal modal logic and LFIs with the Krebs crystal semantics are two faces of the same coin. Our last result concerning self-extension LFIs partially in a certain sense. In a sense, is an extension because it works for non-normal modal logics. But the solution is partial because we cannot get the other way around. That is, we don't know how to recover the minimal bimodal logic from RMBC. Possibly we cannot recover because the, these derived connectives are very weak. Maybe we need to add some additional properties for RMBC in order to recover E plus E. This is a topic that deserves further investigation. Well, that's all, folks. Thank you very much for your attention. These are the references, and well, this the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marcelo. Thank you all. Let's open the session for questions, comments, or remarks or corrections.
Yes, of course, of course.
Your
comments
comments are very much welcome because we're happy with these results. We believe it has several applications, but we'd like to check with you all.
Yeah, by the way, this is the preprint which is available, and the slides are also available if you want to download.
Okay, nice, right. So yeah, this is in the archive, right? Yes, okay.
Yeah, the paper is in archive, and these specific slides are also available for download.
Okay, in your homepage?
I think that you, at this moment, you can download from your...
You can download now. That's true, yes, sure, sure. Ekaterina was showing up in the screen. Maybe she has a question.
Hi, John.
John, yes, please.
You need to habilitate.
I need to turn on, right? Let me see. Oh my goodness, how can I do that? I'm trying to...
I think that Katerina has...
Yeah.
Yes.
If I may, hi.
Okay, yes. Ladies first, please, Katerina. Oh,
thank you very much. No, thank you, Marcelo, for this talk. Very interesting, well-structured. As you know, I have absolutely different background, so sorry if my question will be a little bit naive or not exactly precise. It concerns more generally the LFI's logics and algebraic characterization, and maybe it might lead to something related with your results. Mm-hmm. So my question is that when you were speaking about algebraic characterization, you were always referring to three or four valued background, three or four valued characterizations. I'm just curious. So four valued characterization is a power set, of course, of two elements. Mm-hmm. And I'm curious, does it make sense, technical or even theoretical, to consider not just a power set of two elements, but a power set of power set? In a way how, for example, Shramko and Wanzing defined 16-valued logic, and so on. So this is my question.
Well, thank you very much, Katia, for the question, very interesting question. Indeed, in this talk, I have shown just examples of power set of two elements or four elements. There is one example of a power set of four elements. But in order to get completeness, you need to consider all the power sets, all the bulbs or all the neighborhood structures. Okay? Mm-hmm. But we need to work in this direction. It is possible to prove that this logic have the final model property in order to get the setability. The question of the setability were not taken in this paper, but we hope to do this because it's necessary. Mm-hmm. We have not shown that this produce a decision procedure. We have just make experiments with Isabel in order to get counter models or models of certain logics. We for instance, in order to get an extension of CI which is still paraconsistent, we put this restriction to be consistent in the actions, in the specifications of the logic, and put Isabel in order to look for examples, and it found an example with 16 elements, the power of 4. But for instance, an important question, the logic C1 of La Costa, it is impossible to be paraconsistent because of the result of Carnelli-Marcos that is related strictly to the preservation of the consistency for the conjunction. Mm-hmm. Then the only problem is the propagation of consistency for the conjunctions, which mm-hmm. produce is equivalent to the Morgan law for a specific, the weak, the Morgan law for the conjunction and negation, and then it's possible to have a paraconsistency. Then if you, we can try to, in fact, we are trying to do this, making experiments with propagation, weaker form of propagation of consistency. That is, we define a weaker system than C1, but stronger than CI. Then to put some preservation, not for conjunction, because we know that it's impossible, but for a disjunction, for instance, maybe mm-hmm. disjunction is possible. We don't know yet, but David is working, David is working mm-hmm. hard in this direction. But the answering for your question, it is not necessary to take this finite Boolean algebra, but of course it is. We hope to prove that we have the finite model property. Then we can get the decision procedure for this logic by using these valves.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. It is very interesting.
Thank you, Katia.
Okay, João, I think your microphone is open now.
Is it working? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you very much. So excellent talk. Thanks, Marcelo, and for the paper. I'm really sorry that I didn't have time to read the paper in detail, but you explained everything so well that I probably will be able to ask questions which are relevant. Should I ask all of them at once, or should I ask one by one?
Yes.
All of them at once. So, okay. Could you go back to the slide where you mentioned the result by Avron and Desio, right at the beginning?
The beginning, yes. Well, I don't know how to go to the beginning. More better go ahead. I don't
want
to
go
home.
By hand.
Yeah.
Please be patient.
So in this slide, you say that they have shown that there is no three-valued paraconsistent logic having a deductive implication. That's self-extension. But in the next slide, you mention another result. I think there might be a problem in the way you formulated the result there, because this seems to contradict what you just said before. Actually, the result that he proved recently was about four-valued paraconsistent logic with a deductive implication, an intuitionistic-like implication. So there is one self-extension of four-valued paraconsistent logic with a deductive implication.
Okay. Thank you very much.
This would contradict what you just said before. There is no such three-valued paraconsistent logic.
Perfect. Okay.
This is just an observation. It's not. I think it's not even in the paper. Just mention it there because it's important for the subject. One of the main claims I'm trying to evaluate about the presentation is that you have solved an open problem concerning BC and CI. So I'm trying to recall what the open problem is. It's in my paper. But anyway, I understand that at that time, this was 20 years ago, we didn't know how to add replacement to BC and CI. Mm-hmm. But I think this has been solved a little bit after that, even before our handbook paper. Because mm-hmm. if you consider what you mentioned at the end, my normal modal logic paper, the one in which I show that any normal modal logic can be reformulated as an LFI. Well, in that paper, all the normal modal logics are, they do extend, well, they do respect the axiom CIW, I think is how you call it, the semantic converse of BC, right? Mm-hmm. If you want to have MBC, if you want to extend MBC, you just have to consider frames which are reflexive. And if you want to extend BC, the frames need to be symmetric. The relation needs to be symmetric. And if you want to extend CI, you can use Euclideanity. So we know already for a long time that there are modal logics which extend MBC, BC, CI, and being modal, they do they are congruential, right? They are self-extensional. So I was wondering, in what sense this is the first solution to that problem, because modal logics are a solution to those problems, and those axioms that characterize MBC, BC, and CI can be made valid in such logics.
Yeah, I see. You are talking about this paper specifically.
There are many papers in which I have explored this afterwards, in the papers on negative modalities, so also on sequence systems for negative modalities and so on. So many papers in which I use the same interpretation, which is in there, in this item. Mm-hmm. This was just the first one. So in that paper, in that first one, I also mentioned the connection between properties of the accessibility relation and axioms which come from the LFI tradition. So what I'm saying now is that axioms that concern excluded middle or double negation elimination or the axiom for CI, which is the semantic converse of BC, as you said, somehow these axioms can be made valid in such class of logics. As I said, the excluded middle imposes reflexivity, double negation elimination symmetry, and the axiom CI, or I think the CI, imposes Euclideanity.
Mm-hmm.
So such logics are known to exist. This is already my thesis, chapter 3. So this paper and on other papers that we did afterwards, doing sequence systems for all these logics and so on.
Okay. By taking always this translation, this one.
Yeah. In fact, by taking it as primitive, right? Taking this negation as being. As a primitive negation.
I see. You're right. We need to rephrase the.
But in a certain sense, what you are doing, João, is complementary, because we are doing some kind of a bottom up. A bottom-up approach to the problem, not starting from modal logic, but reaching modal logic from other ways, from other completely different paths.
Okay, yeah. I'm not sure if I understand, but I don't need to. It's just I wanted to just raise a question of the originality claim in the sense of this is the first solution to such and such, because it seems that there are other solutions.
I agree with you, John. It's not the first solution.
This solution seemed to be smaller, in the sense that you didn't demand the logics to be normal, but they could also be non-normal.
Yeah,
that's the part that interests me. Now I come then to a couple of questions which actually are just suggestions for, not observations of what has already been published, but suggestions about relations that you might want to establish. Mm-hmm. And the first one is, now that I imagine that you put a P in front of any normal modal logic. So there is a normal modal logic called K, I call it PK. PK is just K formulated in the language of LFI, okay? Mm-hmm. So you have PKT, PK5, whatever you want. Actually, what I call PK is this logic without the implication. But imagine you have also implication, because that's easy to add. I think adding implication is not a good idea, because it makes things too easy. But anyway, on the connections between PK whatever with the minimal bimodal logic, this is one thing I think it would be interesting to for you to explore a little bit more, because as I said, in all the logics which are normal, I do have CIW, which is one thing that you do not necessarily have. So one question that is one might raise is whether you can arrive from your logics to the normal modal logics just by adding CIW. Is this all that's missing in every case? So if you take your, I don't remember all the names, but R, MBC, if I add CIW, is the logic that you obtain identical to PKT, which is the logic which has MVC.
Yes.
Which is modal and respects the exclude the middle, right? So these connections would be interesting, because then you are acknowledging that these logics exist and exploring the possibility of be actually studying fragments of those logics. And once you are studying these fragments, then I would suggest you to have a look at David Ripley's PhD thesis, because it's precisely about neighborhood semantics for paraconsistent logics and paracomplete logics. So, and he has published some papers on this, also Greg Restow and other people. But his PhD thesis, I think it's from 2009, so 4 years after mine, it's about neighborhood semantics to this kind of logic. So this could be a connection that I was hoping one of my students would study, but I never found anyone. One that I did find decided to go and work in the market. But I think it's a very reasonable thing to study, the connection between the LFIs having a neighborhood semantics, but not necessarily being normal, and the ones which are normal. So the ones which are normal are very easy, as I said, and they're very well known. Other connections basically established by adding CIW. I would not be surprised if that's the case, but I don't think anyone has had a look at this. So
it's just a comment, Jean, with respect to this specific comment. Are you seeing now this slide?
Yeah.
Well, this is an extension of RMBC. With CL, which also implies CIW. Then this is an extension in which the necessitation rule holds for the consistency operator. Maybe there is
So the question in that case would be, if you just add the necessitation rule, is this equivalent to adding CIW?
But this is just a relationship with necessitation at the level of the consistency operator. Okay, not the model. Maybe it could be shed some light into that discussion.
Yeah, precisely, because this would make the non-normal logic normal, right?
So yes, exactly.
The question is whether this is equivalent to imposing CIW.
Exactly. Maybe we don't know if in our framework it will work, because it'd be different, the relationship between consistency operator and the modalities. It's a bit different. Mm-hmm. It's not exactly
investigating if this holds. This would be
exactly, but yeah, interesting ideas.
Yes. An elegant connection with other things which are out there.
Exactly. Yeah, yes.
So I will just make my final question, then, not to take too long. I see Martin is also wants to make a question. I mean, this might be related to what he's going to ask. You promised to talk about algebraic ability. And then you focused on self-extensionality or congruentiality. Do you have anything you would like to say about algebraic ability? Because as we know, and for instance, Umberto Rivietto has pointed this at the logic list, there's not an obvious connection between the two properties. I mean, you might have a logic which is algebraizable without replacement and vice versa, and a logic failing both, of course, or having both. So they're kind of orthogonal. And you didn't say much. You said that you at the beginning you intended to contribute to the solution of to the study of algebraizable logics, LFIs, but then you didn't go back to the subject. So in the case that you are going to do that, and that's like the next work you're doing, and maybe it's already done, whatever, but do you intend also to study things like duality for the Balfis? And especially without implication, because implication, as I said, makes things too easy. This might have a connection, I think, to the work that Liliana Cantu did with Martin Spigalo on involutive stone algebras. And is this the kind of direction you would like to investigate, that you're intending to do?
Yeah, indeed, it is a very interesting property. Concerning algebraizability, we can define a very basic algebraizability by the old method of linear Montarsky. We get the it's an extension, let us say, of the, it's the same that happens with modal logics. There are good analyzer plus some congruential connectives.
Yeah.
And it works. And in this sense, we have a variety which represents in a very strong sense the logic. Then all the questions you are saying now, of course, they deserve to be further researched, because we think that we have a lot of problems to be solved by algebraic means. We think that this minimal solution that we found to the problem of that problem that you posed on BC and CI, this is a minimal solution, which is defined by very with small resources, let's say, the minimum that you need. Then we think that this is interesting because it can be applied to algebraic logic in this sense. We can study dualities and so on, as you suggest.
Okay, thanks. That's all. I just wanted to point out that maybe the what's new about this is precisely the minimality, minimal solution to the problem, because solutions to the problems were already known. And I never try to make the solutions that I proposed minimal. I actually suggested that they could be made smaller through neighborhood semantics. And that's the work of David Ripley, which I think is quite interesting. And in that work, you notice precisely that just making adding congruentiality is not enough. It only starts to get interesting after you add further axioms, because then you can impose reasonable behavior for negation, because negation is just not like any unary connective, right? It's something that you might want to make more powerful. Now, in Ripley's work, of course, he doesn't study LFIs, but as we have shown in many other papers, you don't need to want to study an LFI to have one. You mm-hmm. might just have it without wanting it. And in that case, I just suggest that you have a look at these connections. Perhaps this would be very much in the same line of what you have been doing in some other approach.
Very nice suggestion, João. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, João. Just let me add just one possible application of this setting, this scenario, for instance, for defining probabilistic spaces in the sense of homography, for instance, by using the algebraic setting that we may have in this logic concerning now connecting paraconsistent probability and homography spaces. This would be, I think, a nice application, but of course we have a lot of work still to do. Any other questions or comments? Let me see if I have more questions here.
Martin,
yes.
Hi,
Martin.
Hello, hi, Walter.
Hi, Martin. Hello.
Nice to see you. I liked very much your talk, Marcelo, and I have two questions. One of them is related with what João was just saying, and you presented an extension of PC and CI, and you added two rules, which allows the replacement for the negation and for the consistency operator.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And, my first question is why they are rules? Can we use actions?
Actions.
In order to get this replacement. And I noted that you changed the usual notion of derivation in the logic, and I want to know why the usual notion doesn't work for this approach. That's the first question. And the second question is, are these extensions minimal, as Marcus was just saying? Or in other words, BC is maximal with respect to RBC, and CI is maximal with respect to RCI. That is the way to see if these logics are is the minimal solution.
Mm. Yeah, I see. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, concerning the first question, we are using the degree preserved and consequent relation, as I told. Let's see if I can show again the presentation. I don't know where is the presentation. I minimize. I don't know if it's still here.
One slide.
Well, I don't know if it is still here. Well, I have used, we have used the degree preserving consequent relation, but we can will use also with the same instructors, the BALFIs, the through preserving consequent relation, that is the usual in algebraic logic, in fuzzy logic, for instance. That is, if the premises are one, then the conclusion must be one in every evaluation. Right? The usual, the matrix consequent relation with the one as the only designated value. It is possible to do this. And we get also, in with this semantics, the global semantics, we get paraconsistent models. If you recall, unfortunately, I closed my presentation, then I cannot show again the slides. But in one of the four value models I have presented, there is one in which the negation of one is one. This is a strongly paraconsistent model, let us say, the only one in which a true value is designated and negation is also designated. Right? There are models of this kind, but in such models, I don't talk about this in the presentation because it's too much, but now we can talk about this. In the paper, it's presented this. You cannot satisfy the CF action, which is necessary in order to the logic BC. It is impossible that not alpha implies alpha be designated. Then this strong paraconsistent, the global paraconsistence, let's see, there are models, but you cannot satisfy even relatively inoffensive actions as not alpha implies alpha, for instance. Then we cannot get a solution of the problem on BC by using global semantics. The original our original approach was by using global semantics because it's more traditional, let's say, more. But we found this problem, then this is why we go to a local semantics, let's say. This is with respect to the first question. With respect to the second question, are the RBC, for instance, the minimal extension of BC which satisfies replacement? Well, I will bet that this is the minimal because we are just adding
to be
just adding replacement. I don't know if it's possible to do in with less resources, let's say. And I don't know. I think that it's just the minimum. It's take BC and add replacement.
Yes.
Nothing
okay,
more.
Thank you.
But of course, you need to prove that it's a conservative extension, of course. But it is.
Okay. Thank you, Marcelo.
Thank you, Martin, for your questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Martin. Is there any other question? Remarks or? Okay, just let me inform you people that our next speaker is going to be Eduardo Barrio. I don't know exactly which date, but in, let's say, 3 weeks, more or less. And we are also inviting people that want to collaborate with our seminars. I will make some personal invitations tomorrow in the next days. But for the moment, we have Eduardo Barrio with a topic to be announced and a date to be announced. who is going to help us in the, to make a brilliance to our seminar as well. Okay. So thank you, Marcelo. Very nice work.
Thank you
for presenting fantastic slides. I tried to just to make a test to download the slides, but I could not do. Maybe
because I have
because you have closed the window, right?
Close the window.
Anyone, if anyone wants, they can write you, right? If anyone needs the slides, they can write you. You can send the slides.
Yeah, of course. Please write to me. I will send.
And we will make a little edit to this video and make it soon available at YouTube. Okay, for people that are willing to see it again or that had not an opportunity to see it. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Marcelo. Thanks, Augusto, for helping us technically. See you then next time. Okay?
I don't know how to finish. Here.